Morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us again for this time of prayer, worship, and the Word. Let me read the scripture to us this morning. Proverbs chapter 6, verse 23 in the NIV Bible. It says, "For this command is a lamp, this teaching is a light, and correction and instruction are the way of life." Lord, we thank you, Lord God, that we have another time, another chance to look into your Word. We pray, Lord God, that you would open the truth of your word more and more to us. Lord, that we might find instruction according to your will. Lord, that we might find the life that you have wanted, us to walk into, that you have provided for us even on the cross. Let wisdom follow us, Lord God, for the rest of our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Let us worship God.
You up as you rain down on us. We're overwhelmed.
you, Lord God, for your presence. We ask you, Lord God, that use us, Lord God, even through prayer, Lord, that we might stand in the gap for our nation and for the world, Lord God. Use us, Lord God, that as we fill our lives with your word, that it will overflow and be shared to many who have not heard it or who need encouragement and who need to be stirred up in faith. Use us, Lord God, as your vessels to serve others and to serve many that are looking for answers, that need help in our world today. Open your word to us as we continue to study your word today. In Jesus' name, amen. As a ministry, we have, and as individuals, we have joined in a global prayer movement called Unite 714. And we have been praying this every day for the last 9 weeks, twice a day, 7:14 in the morning and 7:14 in the evening. So we'd like to encourage you to join us. You can go to the website and sign up, and you can get the prayers there and see the direction that we're going to. But this morning, we're going to pray together with so many people from around the world as we pray this prayer. So join us. Lord Jesus, you are the Anointed One. We are thankful our Heavenly Father has given us the Holy Spirit. By the power of your Holy Spirit, enable us to boldly proclaim the good news to a world ravaged by anxiety, fear, panic, and loss. We ask you to pour out your Holy Spirit on our broken world so that 2020 will become the year of the Lord's favor. O God, we ask you to heal our broken world. Only you can replace panic with peace, fear with faith, and grief with grace. Lord, for many of our world's vulnerable people groups, this worldwide quarantine has been a time of darkness, fear, and anger. Many are struggling mentally, emotionally, and financially. Lord, we lift them up. Lift them up out of despair. Deliver them by your great salvation. May they truly discover the eternal freedom only found in you. We thank you for mitigating the effects of COVID-19 and expanding your footprint in the nations of the world. Millions of people are asking you for refuge and protection. We know you hear them and are freshly touching our world. With one voice, we boldly come before your throne of grace in prayer. Heavenly Father, in the name of your Son, Jesus, eradicate COVID-19 and pour out your Spirit on earth. Amen. Amen. We pick up with our series that we started just last week on looking at the book of Proverbs. We are in Proverbs chapter 6 today. And let me read to you a few of the verses from Proverbs chapter 6. It says, "My son, keep your father's commandment and forsake not your mother's teaching. Bind them on your heart always. Tie them around your neck. When you walk, they will lead you. When you lie down, they will watch over you. And when you awake, they will talk with you. For the commandment is a lamp and the teaching a light, and the reproofs of discipline are the way of life." We've heard it many times and probably experienced it as well. They say regret is always at the end. I have experienced it myself, heard friends talk about it. Thankfully, in my own life, it has not happened in a very, in a life and death situation or a very life-changing moment. I just remember years ago or many times, somebody would advise me, don't have anything to do with certain products. But in my desire for the product, and I try to convince myself to purchase it, and finally when I get to purchase it, a few weeks later, how I regret that I bought it. What a mistake. What a waste of money. What a waste of time. I wonder how many times we'd face difficulty because of the wrong decisions we have made in the past. I wonder how many times I could have avoided difficult mistakes if I simply heeded the wisdom that was shared to me or given to me months before. We all know the book of Proverbs is about wisdom. It's a book on wisdom. It's a book about, and the book of wisdom in that sense. Proverbs is a book of wisdom in many areas of life, even if you don't believe in God. But more so if you have a relationship with Jesus, our Lord. Many times we may not like what it says, but mind you, if we heed the book of Proverbs, we will see and experience wisdom. We're in chapter 6 today, and chapter 6 talks about some very real issues we face in life. Some things we face today. These are wise words to live with, to live by, and to live for. Should we want the fruit of wisdom to manifest in our lives? It's also, once again, tells us and shows us the real source of wisdom. With the source of wisdom with us, we can face anything, anywhere. We can be anywhere. We can face situations anytime, and we would know and we would be able to walk out through any trial and challenge if we know the source of wisdom. I realize this. A wise man is not the source of wisdom, but a wise man knows the source of wisdom. A wise man may not be wise, but he definitely knows who is. So let's jump into Proverbs chapter 6. And in a sense, Proverbs chapter 6 is wisdom for daily living, wisdom for different issues that we face in life. And it's said in a very upfront, take it or leave it manner. So let's look at a few things. It's wisdom for finance. Verse 1 says this, "My son, if you have put up security for your neighbor, have given your pledge for a stranger." The next verse says, "It's a snare. Get out of it. Don't be a guarantor to someone. Don't put up security for someone's loan or make a pledge to cover someone." I've seen relationships destroyed because this was not heeded. Whether you believe it or not, I've seen relationships challenged and some even destroyed. Plain and simple wisdom says, don't do it. Secondly, it has wisdom for how we should use our mouth, or what our mouth says and what our mouth reveals about us. Verse 12 says, "A worthless person, a wicked man, goes about with crooked speech." Your speech shows your true character. Your speech created your character. Who has your speech created? What has your speech created for you? It can't be anymore. We always say this, "I'm just joking." It can't be, "I'm just joking" all the time. One day, what you keep saying will be the truth. Your truth. Next one is work. Proverbs chapter 6 talks about work. It says, "How long will you lie there, O sluggard? When will you arise from your sleep? A little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the hands to rest, and poverty will come upon you like a robber, and want like an armed man." Wise, diligent work will produce good fruit. Be wise with the seasons. Be wise with the work. The example is the ant. There's a season to work. There's a season to gather. There's a season that you cannot gather. There's a season for work that prepares you, as well as a season that we can't work. The key is know the wisdom and the season for our day. Next one is the issue of the heart. Verse 24, it says, "To persevere you, to preserve you from the evil woman, from the smooth tongue of the adulteress. Do not desire her beauty in your heart. Do not let her capture you with her eyelashes. For the price of a prostitute is only a loaf of bread, but a married woman hands down a precious life." Can a man carry fire
next to his chest and his clothes not be burned? Or can one walk on hot coals and his feet not be scorched? It says, and gives us wisdom, protect your heart. Don't play with temptation, especially when it comes to lust. Don't try to find out if you're strong. In fact, the Bible tells us, run away. Don't desire, don't play with it, don't test it, don't try it, you'll get burned. And lastly, the one we want to really look at is the source of wisdom. This is the most important key, I believe, in this chapter. It says, my son, keep your father's commandment and forsake not your mother's teaching. Bind them in your heart always, tie them around your neck. When you walk, they will lead you. When you lie down, they will watch over you. And when you awake, they will talk with you. For the commandment is a lamp and a teaching, a light, and the reproofs of discipline are the way of life. It was expected during biblical times that very wise parents teach their children to have a relationship with God, to know and embrace God's word and God's command, and to live for God. That's why it says, my son, keep your father's commandment. Remember the words of God. Remember the relationship of God with your father as he taught you. Parents have the privilege, the opportunity, and the responsibility to raise a wise generation. The wisdom of the next generation lies in the hands of the parents that we can impart, we can teach, we can lead them, we can lead our children, the next generation, to the source of wisdom. Wisdom can be passed down, taught, and even imparted. Wise parents not only provide financially, but wise parents must give loving, spiritual, and godly leadership, impart wisdom. Proverbs 13 verse 22 says this, a good man leaves an inheritance of moral stability and goodness to his children's children, and the wealth of the sinner finds its way into the hands of the righteous for whom it was laid up. This is not talking about a financial inheritance, but a God-loving, God-fearing, God-obeying inheritance that we can leave to our children and leave to our children's children. And as we pour our life into living that godly inheritance to our children and their children's children, the scripture says that the wealth of the sinner finds its way eventually into the hands of the righteous for whom it was laid up. If we teach, if we impart, if we leave godly wisdom, God-fearing, God-loving, and God-obeying heritage to our children, the wealth of the wicked God has stored up for our children and even for ourselves. So if we want wisdom, let's close with this. The scripture says, bind the word in your heart, treasure it. In a real sense, keep mining the word of wisdom, for the wisdom of God. Store the word of God in your heart. Keep filling your heart. Because one day when you need it, that word will come out of your heart and out of your mouth. So when we need the word of God, it will flow from the treasures of our heart. Then it says, tie the word of God, the source of wisdom, around your neck. Focus on the word of God. Our neck controls where we face. We make a choice when wisdom is needed. We turn our face toward the word of God. The word is the voice we listen to. The word is the manual we need to learn and understand. Then it says, then the word will lead you. We will know the next step. This is the map, the road sign, the GPS that we can follow. The word will watch over you. We will be protected. This is my alarm system. This is our armor. This is our weapon, the sword of the Spirit. The word will talk to you. We will hear God. The word is the light. The word will discipline. will correct and adjust us toward the right path. October 27, 2019, we were doing our ride for life, Visayas, in the Visayas. From our during the October 27, that was our road trip, our ride from Tacloban to Sorsogon. We left Tacloban about 3:30 in the morning because we had to make the ferry and not miss it. When we were in the city, it was still fine. I could still see, I could see well because of the street lights, and I could see the bike in front of us. But when we got out in the countryside, when we got out to the hills and the twisties, and it was, there was no light, no street lights, and then roads were new. There was no painted divisions on the road. I did not know where to go. It was like I was riding so slow. I could only travel as far as my lights could go, and it wasn't very far, and I was having a difficult time until one of the guys volunteered. His bike was full of lights, and he stayed in front of me, and he told me, "Bishop, follow me." And I followed him until daylight broke. The lights dictated my pace. The light kept correcting my direction. The light kept me at a disciplined pace. The light got me through this difficulty. As we close, James chapter 1, verse 15. If any of you is deficient in wisdom, let him ask of the giving God, who gives to everyone liberally, ungrudgingly, without reproaching or fault finding, and it will be given him. Lord, we come to you right now, Lord, especially during this time. Lord, we need wisdom. So we ask you for wisdom, that you would continually, Lord God, lead us, guide us, light the path before us with your wisdom and with your word, that we might walk out of this according to your will and into your purpose. Let us worship God. Let me read this, the last scripture to us again, and declare this and proclaim this as a blessing to us today. James chapter 1, verse 5 says this: if any of you is deficient in wisdom, let him ask of the giving God, who gives to everyone liberally and ungrudgingly, without reproach or fault finding, it will be given to him. Lord, thank you that you are a God of wisdom. who gives wisdom, joyfully gives wisdom to those that ask. We can live in our world with wisdom. We can walk out of this crisis in wisdom, and we can conquer the new normal with your wisdom. In Jesus' name, amen.